just talking about the clinical presentation of the high flow vascular malformation. So during childhood, these lesions are generally latent, quiescent, and they are just noticed as the bluish skin discoloration. Later on, this bluish skin lesion may be a pulsatile, but as the child grows, there may be dystrophic skin changes, bleeding, ulceration, tissue necrosis, volume overload, and also may lead to the CHF. So this Iskobinger clinical classification is very important in terms of taking any decision regarding their treatment. So there are four type Iskobinger classification, type 1, type 2. Generally, type 1 and type 2 lesions are just followed up maybe by a radiology or by imaging. But type 3 and type 4 lesions definitely require some kind of treatment because this is the time when patients generally have some kind of severe system symptoms, like he may be bleeding ulcer or severe pain. So treatment actually depend upon the severity of the related symptoms and location of the lesion. I just mentioned type 1 and type 2, just follow up. Type 3 and type 4 may require treatment. So if we see the treatment, historically, these high flow ABMs have been a very difficult entities to manage. Surgery has been the mainstay for decades. But with the recent advancement in the understanding of histopathology and angio architecture of these high flow lesions and development of in the field of interventional radiology, now these all lesions can be very well managed by endovascular embolization. And this endovascular embolization actually has emerged as a preferred treatment option. However, still, surgery has a role. And in collaboration with the intervention radiology, result can be much better. So actually, we should have a clear aim before going to treat these kind of lesions, because most of the time, these lesions presented in very late stage. So it's very difficult to treat them completely. So your treatment strategy should be focused, like what you are going to treat. And also the decision depend upon the type of ABM and the location of ABM also. Most important is if a patient has presented to you with the bleeding and pain. So bleeding and pain most of the time is due to the venous hypertension. So your aim to treat in this kind of patient should be to decrease the inflow more aggressively, so that venous hypertension get reduced. Once the venous hypertension goes down, the bleeding and pain will come down also. On the contrary, if see a person who is having a very, destruction over the skin or non-healing ulcer, then this clinical picture is more suggestive of shunting, ischemia. Ischemia because of the shunting of the oxygenated blood into the venous system. So the normal tissue is hypoperfused. So in this case, your aim should be to reduce the shunt flow and to increase the flow of the normal tissue. So based on these signs and symptoms, one should plan actually what is the aim of the treatment. So if you talk about the endovascular embolization, so in endovascular embolization, our focus is just to target the nidus or that central shunt area. So just if we can block those shunts, then the pressure will come down. And also we should aim to prevent the formation of a collateral, because most of the time you once block one feeding vessel, then other feeding vessels open up. So our aim should be to embolize as much collateral as possible. And at the same time, avoiding proximal occlusion of that feeding vessel. Because if you are occluding the vessel proximally, then there are higher chances of further new collateral formation. Generally, a step-by-step approach is best. and you should plan these kind of lesions to treat in a multiple sessions at a regular interval, because more aggressive you will be, there are higher chances of developing ischemia. High flow nature of these lesions actually makes our job little difficult, because whatever embolizing material we are using, there should be some amount of time for which this should come into the contact with the endothelium, so that it can destroy the endothelium and can block the stent. So actually we should we can use some measures to reduce the flow while doing this embolization therapy. Now coming on to the approach, how we can approach these lesions. So basically there are three approaches, three routes by which we can approach these lesions: transarterial, transvenous, direct percutaneous nidus puncture. I will just come in detail when to use, which approach when to use. So basically, from the treatment point of view, it is very important that we should have a very clear-cut understanding of the anatomy and the nidus morphology. So there has been various classification to, and they have divided these high flow lesions in various categories. So one very popular is the CODO ABM classification system. It actually helps in deciding the treatment approach. So here you can see the type 1, type 2, type 3, A and B. We divide them into three categories. So in type 1, you may have a one arterial feeder or up to three. So any arterial feeder, any number less than three, draining into a single vein. So these are comes into type one. And to treat these lesions, actually transarterial or transvenous, both approach can be used. Coming on the type two lesion, where actually there are multiple arterioles which are communicating with the single vein. So again here transvenous approach is best, because to occlude these arterioles, because they are quite smaller in diameter, most of the time it's very difficult to deposit the embolic material into these arterioles. So it's better to treat these lesions by a transvenous approach. And now last category is type 3 and type 3A and type 3B lesions. So for type 3A, again, transarterial approach is better, and you can actually tackle with this route only, because you don't have a much dilated veins to come from the transvenous route. Now, type 3B, these are the most difficult lesion and to treat by endovascular means, because here both the arteries, the connections, the fistulous connections are actually at the level of arterioles. And the veins are also dilated, and channels are like a huge multiple number of channels. So they are actually very difficult to treat. So here you need to combine both transarterial, transvenous, as well as the direct percutaneous approach. In 2015, again, then this classification came into the picture, which is supposed to be a more organized classification based on the angio architecture of the ABM given by AICS. So here they divided the high flow lesions into four categories. Type one is direct AVF. Here you see artery directly communicating with the single vein. These kind of lesions are more common into the nervous system and in pulmonary AVM circulation. Here these lesions are easy to treat by endovascular approach. All you need to just put some mechanical barrier at the level of the connection. Then type 2A and type 2B, these are actually CODO type 2 kind of a lesion only. Here the outflow vein in type 2B is actually dilated, while in type 2A it's not dilated. So we'll just see the clinical cases of these kind of cases. Again, here we see the type 4 lesion. They are tissue infiltrative AVM, and again very difficult to treat by a transcatheter, transarterial, transvenous, and sometimes you need to treat these lesion direct puncture of the lesions and put some embolic material into the feeding vessels. So this coming to the one case, this was the 62-year female and complaining of breathlessness from last 4 to 5 years. She was visiting so many places. And then she developed occasional hemoptysis, and then CT scan was done for this to evaluate this hemoptysis. And on CT scan, she was discovered type 1 AVF between the descending branch of right pulmonary artery and vein. And here you can see this dilated tortuous vein directly communicating with this feeding pulmonary artery branch. So we did the super selective catheterization of this feeding vessels, and here you can see took some idea how fast flow it is, and then put some coils and then glue. And now you can see in this last check run, because of this stunting, in first run you barely see pulmonary artery branches, but once we have blocked this stunt, you can see these very nicely pulmonary artery branches. So next case, she was a 19-year-old girl. She was having a visible swelling at the wrist level in the right hand and was having severe pain. So we did the angiography, and again here you can see the high flow nidus stunting in directly oxygenated blood directly into the vein. And there are multiple feeders, and the veins are actually not dilated. So this make AIC type 2A lesion. And we did the super selective angiography, identify the feeder, put the glue selectively in these feeders. It was actually, I have just taken 2-3 images, but it was a very difficult case. Multiple, more than 7-8 feeders, I need to selectively cannulate and then put the glue. And then I sent this patient for the surgical resection to Dr. Rajiv. But somehow the girl was not interested for surgical resection, so she just lost to follow up, and then returned back after around 6 months with the recurrence of these symptoms. So I did the second sitting. Now this the second procedure, check runs. Again, you can see the reappearance of a new feeder. We put the glue again by super selectively cannulating all these channels. And here you can see the nice blue cast, and this was the final check run. Almost 80 to 90% debranching. And then I referred this for the surgical, and this time she got the surgical resection, and more than one year follow-up has been completed. She is doing perfectly fine. Another 62-year-old female. So she came to us with a pain, bleeding from inside of the mouth, and X-ray and CT shows destruction of mandible with a large AVM sitting inside the ramus of mandible. And this is the left eye CCA run, and you can see bunch of stunting and a dilated vein draining into the vein inside this mandibular bone, which was causing actually erosion. So we super selectively cannulated all the channels, and it was again a very difficult case to treat. But after multiple sessions, this was the final run, and where you hardly see any stunt now. And then again, I referred this patient to Dr. Rajiv for further surgical management. He removed and put some bone graft into the mandible, and the patient is doing fine. So coming on the endovascular, in general, endovascular arterial approach would be used first to reach the nidus. If we talk about all the three approaches, first approach would be the transarterial. You should reach the nidus. And if you feel putting the embolic material from the nidus might not reach up to the nidus, then you just reduce the flow from that side and took a venous puncture and inject the embolic material from the transvenous route. So it could be actually combined transarterial, transvenous, And once the transarterial and transvenous approaches are exhausted, then you can go for the direct puncture of the nidus and putting some embolic material directly. Often surgery and embolization are complementary to each other. Lesions should be first devascularized by endovascular embolization. This helps in reducing in the blood loss during surgery, and this also gives surgeons quite a good amount of confidence while removing the lesion. Now, some words about the embolic materials. Generally, embolic materials are two kinds: temporary embolic material like gel foam. They don't have any role here because most of the time we need the permanent embolic material, which are maybe particles, coil, liquid, or some amplatz plug. Actually, ethanol is supposed to be the most destructive embolic agent, liquid embolic agent, but it's very difficult to control also. But in the setting of where you can control it nicely, then this is the best embolic material. However, you can also use the glue or the onyx. Onyx is actually slow in polymerization, so it gives you a better control if the lesion is quite large and is having a huge amount of feeders, then onyx works well. PVA sometimes might be required. So to conclude my talk, advancement in imaging and interventional radiology have brought radiology to the forefront of vascular anomaly management. Embolic therapy and other percutaneous treatment like sclerotherapy, the kind of cases just shown by Dr. Rajiv, by sclerotherapy, so good result. Actually, now can we consider the first line treatment for these vascular anomalies? However, still, despite these advances in the management of vascular anomalies, if treatment remains complex and recurrences are quite common, and it remains a multimodality treatment, including surgery. Thank you.